The normal growth parameters that we monitor include the weight, the height, and the head circumference. Growth is nothing but the physical development of the child. And these parameters reflect what we need to monitor in terms of their achieving their potential. The general timing when we review the child for growth monitoring is at the time of birth, when we assess where the child is in relation to other children of their age. This is called plotting the baby on their own percentile. The target growth potential will depend on where the child falls at this stage, as well as the family growth pattern. There are a few factors that affect the baby's growth at the time of birth, mainly the situation when the baby is in the womb, the placenta, the supply to the baby, whether it is healthy, and whether the nourishment to the baby is happening in the right pace. If the mother has high blood pressure or other conditions which affect the nutrition of the fetus, the baby may be growth restricted. And when it comes to growth restriction, as I will explain later, the growth is not predictable. So we have further checks usually at the time of vaccination visits, and this will depend on the country you live in. So usually in UAE it's 2, 4 and 6 months. In India, for example, it's 6 weeks, 10 weeks and 14 weeks. And subsequent visits can be at 9 months and 1 year. However, if there are any concerns, we will have to develop and review the child earlier. After 1 year of age, usually if the advice has been given appropriately, 6 monthly reviews in the clinic plus the parents monitoring the weight gain at regular intervals should be adequate. Some of the important facts that the parent should know about the weight gain or loss of the baby: there is always an initial period of weight loss followed by weight gain after that. The baby returns back to the birth weight by 10 to 14 days. This of course depends on the feeding, how well the feeding is established and so on. The weight gain is 20 to 30 grams per day in the first month. It then reduces, and you can roughly estimate it as 10 to 15 grams per kilogram per day, going by the weight of the baby as a measure as well. And a parent should remember that they should go by the growth chart and the percentile of the baby's growth rather than exact numbers. They should consider apps that can be used on your phone as well that allow you to plot and monitor the child's growth trajectory. In the beginning, we can measure the weight 2 weekly. The height measurement 2 monthly is adequate. Head circumference during the clinic visits is enough, so very rarely that the parents need to measure the head circumference at home unless there is a concern with the head circumference growth. So this is an example of what a growth chart looks like. So this is for the weight and the length of boys, and the age range is mentioned here, so from birth to 24 months or 2 years of age. So the premature baby is usually plotted on this chart only after they become corrected age of term. So if a baby is born at 30 weeks, for example, they become corrected age of term only when they are 10 weeks old. So this is called the corrected gestational age. And for a term baby, you start with 0, and then as they grow older, you keep growing on that. The lines here reflect percentiles, and the percentile lines indicate the potential or the range in which the child is supposed to grow. So according to the chart that you're following, the first bottom line may indicate the 3rd centile, 5th centile, 10th centile, 25th and then 50th centile, and then you go up on the 75th, 90th, 95th and 98th. So percentile is nothing but a distribution of a particular measure that you are looking at in relation to population. So suppose you have taken 100 children of that age, for example at 3 months of age. Third centile means only 3% of the babies are below that particular weight range. And if you say 50th percentile, 50% of the babies are at that, below that, and 50% are above. So that's what we call the average. So remember that your child is supposed to grow along the trajectory for that baby, and there are situations where there is catch-up growth. In some situations, like an infant of diabetic mother, where the baby is big at birth, sometimes they track down a little to correct for the familial pattern. So most of the time the baby continues to grow on the smaller side in the small for gestational age, where it is due to family pattern. If the baby was growth restricted due to intrauterine insufficiency, like placental insufficiency from high blood pressure or other conditions. They may show a catch-up growth. It can be early catch-up in the first couple of months onwards, or it can be late catch-up after the first 1 to 2 years. So the factors influencing growth include the birth weight, the family growth pattern, both in childhood and current pattern of the parents. So the pattern in childhood is important in terms of constitutional growth delay, for example, where one of the parents may have late puberty and their growth spurt is delayed, and the same pattern may reflect in the baby. There may be short stature in the family, so the parents may be of normal height, but one of the grandparents may have a short stature, and skip genes can happen. And so even if the mid-parental height is suggestive, if there are short family members, you may consider that. Prematurity and growth restriction also lead to growth failure in some babies. The premature babies who are very premature, like the extreme premature babies who are below 1 kilo, may continue to grow on the smaller side even after discharge. The babies who are in exclusive breastfeeding tend to grow at a slower pace and compared to babies on formula feeds, but that doesn't mean that formula feeding is better, because the baby has to maintain their appropriate growth pattern, and overfeeding them may lead to future health problems. So catch-up growth, as I mentioned, is seen in growth restricted or preterm babies after the initial period of slow growth, and the timing varies. The best option for the parents is to be satisfied with the growth as long as the birth centile is at least maintained. So the baby should self-regulate the intake, and catch-up growth will happen when due. We shouldn't be forcing with high-calorie milk, for example, or forcing the baby to feed at repeated intervals. So that is one of the commonest reasons that we find problems related to reflux, and lack of control, obesity becomes a problem in the future as well. So pushing the growth-restricted babies to take in more than they need or use high-energy feeds may increase the future risk of obesity, hypertension, diabetes, and heart disease. This is called Barker's hypothesis, or the pre-programming effect. So a child who is destined to be small, if you force them to grow faster, it's not good for their cardiovascular health. So obviously, if you're meant to be Laurel, you continue to be that way, and it's not good to become hardy in that sense. So obesity is a big problem, and we should be careful with that. So this is a quick summary. I'll stop.